A Journey with Dominic in the Order of Preachers. Part 10. Dominic, the Heritage We Share. Dominic returned on foot, as was his custom, to Bologna for the second general chapter, which was held on Pentecost in June 1221. The order had so grown that administratively it created provinces so it could better deal with the differing growing needs. After the chapter, Dominic preached in the area of Treviso and Venice. He returned to Bologna in mid-July, realizing that he was ill. He was exhausted from the heat and his travels. To give him some relief from the heat, the friars took him to Santa Maria in Monte. When he realized he was about to die, and the monk there would not have allowed him to be buried in Bologna, he was moved back to the convent. Dominic had no room of his own there, no spare habit. All was provided for him. The brethren came to him, and he spoke with them. He promised to be of more good to the order after his death than in life. Dominic died on August 6th in 1221, the Feast of the Transfiguration. The friars knew the master and wanted to concentrate on the holy preaching, so they did not encourage the cult of his sanctity or even his canonization until the call was overwhelming. There were many miracles, and his simple tomb was not enough for the people. The friars were nervous about moving his body and the possible smell of decay as they moved him to a glorious tomb. So, during the night, his original tomb was opened so he could be translated to a place of rest at San Domenico. As they did so, a mysterious sweet fragrance filled the church, and there was great joy. Dominic's tomb preaches about his life and the revelation of Christ to all through his preaching. And so the choice of the sculpture of the Epiphany on the front of the tomb. Dominic's life of voluntary poverty, searching for truth, love of the poor, compassion for the heretic and sinner, gives one pause. Dominic never tried to gather power or privilege to himself. He had refused bishoprics, fostered democratic rule in the order, and was known for his prayer and fasting. From Osma to Rome, there were stories at his canonization of people who had observed him through hidden windows in different churches as he prayed at night. Dominic knew that who we are is the best and most basic form of preaching. His example spoke to heretic and saint. His listening ear and kindness gave him a wisdom we find revealed in the many paintings of him with Mary, Mary Magdalene, and Catherine of Alexandria. Dominic performed miracles, raising the dead, healing the sick, dispelling demons, having scrolls fly out of the flames. But these extraordinary events were never the center of the tradition handed down about him. They were only the means to prove his sanctity. The gift of Dominic is the fidelity to the search for truth of Jesus Christ wherever it is found. His faithfulness to the holy preaching, knowing that he had to speak to those who were in need of God's merciful love, caused him to adapt practices of penance, not for their own sake, but so that his preaching could be heard by those most in need of it. Dominic cared deeply for the poor and those who were oppressed. His charity was the result of heartfelt transformation to reveal God's love. Dominic sought God first, always and in all ways. He shared the fruits of his contemplation of Scripture and of life. What part of the tradition of Dominic attracts me? To what does my life give witness as it preaches? How can we, as an order of preachers, be an epiphany in our own time?